I mean, recently we've kind of seen a lot of young players in the Indian national team, like so Sahal Abdul Samad, who's from Kerala. We have Brandon as well. We have Anirudh Thapa, Udanta Singh, people like that. They're actually coming up. They are very young players as well. And they've kind of shown also that they have potential, but they're still stuck in the ISL. So do you think probably moving to a country, moving to a league like Thai League or maybe the Indonesian League, maybe perhaps, or the J League probably could be the first step up for these players?
It's a difficult one because, like, Indonesia, I don't think the level is high enough that it's worthwhile moving there. You know, you need to, I think, for Brandon Fernandez or Adanta Singh or Anirudh Thapa or somebody like that, can they move to China, play in China Division One or China Super League, for example? For the ones of a slightly lower level, can they go and play a good level in Thailand? So it's still a level above the I-League and still probably a level above the ISL. For me, ISL is probably somewhere between mid-level English League 2 and really bottom-end English League 1. But you have players who are a higher level than that and players who are a lower level than that. Like, there's a huge variance of ability within each team. You have the same in MLS. You have players who are like top-end Champions League players and guys who are Scottish League One level players. You know, there's a huge discrepancy among some teams and some players within the same team. But I think for your best ones, the issue is it's a strange one because if you have to play so many Indian players on the pitch at one time, the value of the Indian player goes up. So even an average level player is disproportionately paid, you know, what they should be paid in India. So if you don't have the rule that says you need to have, say, six Indians on the pitch, if you need six Indians on the pitch and there's, you know, 10, 12 teams in the league, are there 72 really, really good level players? No, there's maybe 12. So those 12 ones are getting paid disproportionately from what they would do if they played abroad. And even the ones that are not so good are getting disproportionate wages. So then you have a situation where these guys are earning far too much money to even think about moving abroad, to become a better player, to make the national team better. So it's one of those things where, you know, you make a rule to try and get boys on the pitch, but because the player pool is so small, they're going to play anyway, and they're going to be paid far too much for what they're worth. So, you know, if you say to somebody like, I don't know, Jerry Lawrenzuela, come and play in Scotland, we'll pay you £800 a week. He's going to say no because he's going to earn three or four times that in India. So it's one of those things where players are paid, you know, far too much for what they're worth, and it's a short career, and a lot of them come from poverty, so they're never going to leave that. So you're never going to get players leaving early enough. So you need to raise the level of your own league before you can even think about getting them to go elsewhere.
Also, coming on to another point, which is the fan culture, probably in the subcontinent. We see that the fans here, I mean, most people probably grew up watching the English Premier League. We have a lot of Barcelona and Real Madrid fans as well, fans of Italian football too, in the Serie A, Inter fans, Milan, Juventus as well, probably a little as of late, after probably the Ronaldo move and all. But do you think the fan culture in India is probably probably one of the reasons why, or probably should fan culture be one of the triggers for the football in India to improve?
I think the fan experience is more important. The fan culture is there. Like Kerala Blasters, when I was in Indian ISL, they were getting 40,000 to 50,000 in the stadium. You know, that's not uncommon for them. Kolkata has the same. You go in Mohan Bagan v East Bengal and there's huge numbers in the stadium, even Kashmir games. So the fan culture is there. The issue is not getting people into the stadium or getting people to support the team. I remember Ashley Westwood arriving in Bangalore and building a club from scratch. So now they've got one of the best supporter groups. So it's not that the fan culture is not there. It's the experience in the stadium is terrible. Stadiums are run down, not fit for purpose in most cases, barely decent changing rooms at some level. So I think in terms of like the fan experience, you really need the clubs to work on making it a better experience to get more people interested in going. And it might be that, you know, it's kind of what the phrase would be, but it's kind of like just accepted that the stadium's rubbish. Like if you go to Ambedkar Stadium, it's terrible. But, you know, you can use it for the national team games because it's, you know, the fans are on top of the stadium. So it's on top of the pitch, so it's nice to play in. But in terms of getting supporters in the stadium, you know, how does that make, you know, how does that generate more revenue for the clubs to invest in other things?
Yep. And probably coming up to the last phase of this interview, would like to actually ask you about your future plans. And we have a patron who had a question for you. His question was, how did you actually get into this particular role of being the head of analysis and scouting for the opposition at Dundee United? Also, he also had to ask that, do you use tools like Wyscout or Smart Scout probably to judge different statistics? Do you use different statistics with this platform? Yeah.
So how did I get into the job is the first question. When you're a coach, you spend a lot of time thinking and analysing. So I spent a lot of time analysing different teams, different systems, different structures, understanding like tactical theory and things like that, how that can be applied to player development and team development. So that was my starting point, was from a coach. And then obviously 10 Sports gave me a job doing analysis on TV. So then your analytical background becomes stronger. And then you start to think about, as a coach who's doing analysis, well, how can I be more evidence-based? You know, you can make stuff up as you go, but you need to start to understand what actually happens in a game. So I started learning about things like StatsBomb. StatsBomb were putting out a lot of good stuff in between 2012 and 2015 when I was in India. So I started learning about data analytics and how that can be applied to analysis and coaching processes. And then started looking at, well, how can you use data within recruitment? How can you understand what a player does within the context of what happens in a game? And then this job at Dundee United came up because I spoke to the academy manager and Robbie, who hired me. So it's more just like, if you're capable of doing something within the context where it can be valuable, so like analysis to help a coach, that's really helpful because you have a coaching background. I think a lot of people have experience using Sports Code or Wyscout, but don't really know how to contextualize it. So it's, you need to put it all together. That's the first thing. You need to then understand how your analysis can be turned into a game plan. Even within team selection or training practices, you need to understand, you know, how might that look. It's not to say that you're going to say to the manager, look, here's a training session I would do, but if he was to ask you and you didn't know, then you'd be floundering. So it's important that you have that background to be able to do that. And then I think the next bit of, you know, do you use tools? Of course you do. Like we use Sports Code to clip the games, take XMLs from Wyscout, which we use for doing data analysis, and then obviously opposition analysis, so your own team analysis, and you can look at projections and things like that. So there's certain tools you can use, but some tools are really expensive and some tools are cheaper, and I think, you know, you've got to make the best of what you can. You can't always have everything that you want, so it's one of those things where you need to be able to do the job before you go into it. You can't just learn on the job and then hope that you get better at it, because ultimately, you know, the manager and the staff have got to win games, and if they can't rely on you to give them good information, then you're not going to last.
And probably the last question for you would, I mean, it's kind of a cliche question which everyone asks, but what is exactly your future plans, or, you know, what do you expect probably from yourself in the future?
I don't know. I always kind of thought I would be a head coach. Don't know if that's possible. Don't know if that's what I want to do. Maybe go down the route of a head of recruitment or sporting director and organise a club in that sense, rather than being a coach who might get the sack after 6 months or a year and a bit. You never know, because it's pretty common now. So I spoke to the manager before he left quite a lot about this, and, you know, it's probably a more secure job with similar responsibility if you're the head of recruitment, to try and build a team, and you can get 3 or 4 years to do that. So that's something that I'm trying to explore just now. So We'll see how this season goes. Obviously, we're in the Premier League. We're looking for a new manager. We need to try and put things together in place that were postponed because of coronavirus. So my own future, I don't really know. I enjoy what I do. I like the club. I like the people I work with. Fortunately, one of them's just left. So we'll see how it evolves in the next few months.
Yep. All the best to you, Stevie, actually, for your future endeavors. Hope you kind of get a lot of success your way. And yes, that brings us to the end of this short interview. Thank you so much, Stevie, for coming on to our show. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
No problem. Cheers for having me.
Cheers. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Right.